بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته my dear brothers and sisters in Islam and welcome back to the seerah of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. As we left you last time, we talked about the pillars of being steadfast because we had to decipher this hieroglyphics. How did the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم do it? Amazingly enough, and we talked about these six pillars inshallah that hopefully we can implement in our daily life to learn from it inshallah. Today's episode, we're going to talk about the da'wah kharij Makkah. The propagation now starting to go outside of Makkah. Because we understand that now Prophet Muhammad ﷺ does not have the backing of his uncle Abu Talib and his wife radiallahu anha, Ummul Mu'mineen Khadija. So he's now seeking to go outside of Makkah. On the way out, it was accompanied by Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhu warda, and his story is beautiful. Inshallah, we'll talk about it some other time. He was on the way to a Taif. And by the way, it was 60 miles away from Mecca. 60 miles away from Mecca. I know it sounds like nothing to you now because you get into your air-conditioned car, you put it on cruise, in no time you're there. But this was the desert heat. And you multiply by 1.6 if the brothers don't know the kilos. And he was walking to Taif. Walking, ya akhi. You understand? 60 miles on his feet, walking for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula to continue this da'wah. If a gate closes, you can't sit back and say, oh, you know what? I tried, man. That's it. I can't do any more da'wah work. You know, I can't take the heat. I get out of the kitchen. Why are you doing, man? He says, no, you know, I have to comb my rabbit's hair and I have a little bit hangnail on my pinky. I can't take it, man. Prophet Muhammad sallam walked for 60 miles. Allahu Akbar, ya akhi. So we have to learn something here, inshallah. Da'wah does not stop because of a hurdle. Our teachers taught us a beautiful lesson that we have to share with you. He says you have a goal. If your goal to go downtown, for example, wherever you live, and you see hurdles, do you actually walk into the hurdles or you bang into them just to get to that? He says, no. You have to work around the hurdles in order for you to get to your goal, because that's the goal, our means. This is just means to get to the goal. And the goal is Jannah, inshallah. And Prophet Muhammad says, لَا يُؤْمِنَ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يَكُونُ هَوَاهُ تَبَعًا لِمَا جِئْتُ بِهِ. You will not complete your belief unless your whims and desires are compatible or like with I come with. Meaning the Qur'an and Sunnah and Da'wah. So Prophet Muhammad leads by example. He's accompanied with Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhu warda, 60 miles walking. And he finds out that who is the leaders and he wants to talk to them. Is Abdi Layl, wa Mas'ud, wa Habib. They are the three leaders. And they were the sons of Amr ibn Umayr al-Thaqafi. Of course, he was the leader of the Banu Thaqif, Ta'if. Same Ta'if. And he went to talk to them first. He says, I'm coming here. Here's who I am. Here's what I'm doing. Here's my message. Allow me to come and talk to your people. They met him with the most difficult not hospitable at all, let's put it this way. So Prophet ﷺ still did not give up. He says, okay, if you do not want me to do this and you're going to treat me badly and whatever, you know, hide this of what we have between all of us. So don't tell people about it. Just let me be with the people and let them hear me out. They didn't allow him. Not only that, they actually asked the people of Ta'if to two lines. They had two lines after Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Even the kids were coming out, throwing the stones at the feet. Even Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu anhu, he used to cover Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Even his head was hurt. That's how it was, akhi. It wasn't you go in and knock on somebody's door, say, Assalamu alaikum. I have this booklet with you. No? Okay, thank you. Assalamu alaikum. It wasn't like that, man. It was much, these were hands-on, this was serious da'wah. Okay, so may Allah bless you for your effort, for the da'wah, whatever it may be, as you will see the best da'wah, as inshallah you will see a little bit in this story. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ now is having a very difficult time. After specifically the Aam al-Huzn, the year of sadness, as we talked about previously. And now he's saying he feels despair, he's coming back broken. Of course, his spirit is not a broken man, he's the best of creation, you understand. But his spirit now is a bit, he feels a bit, it's hard, it's difficult on him to take. On the way, he was actually going to the tribes, asking every tribe that he passes by. On the way to Al-Ta'if from Mecca, he was asking people. He wasn't just going. No, he was working da'wah right through, asking people to come to the path of Allah, giving them the best guidance, and so on and so forth. Which teaches a couple of things. Not because you're going to say the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the Quran and you give him the sunnah and all that stuff and you give him the proof that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists and there's only one God and the sunnah of this and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that. They will take it. We discuss these issues with a lot, even when we sit on a multi-faith committee, and we discuss these issues, proof, and even with learned people that they should know better. It's not that easy. In the hand of Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that as we talked about previously, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتِ. You will not guide those whom you love. So the hidayah comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what's the condition? وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Those who strive in our path, we will guide them to our ways, inshallah. So if they seek to be guided and not fish for faults, they really want to find the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide them, inshallah. Allah will not let them astray, inshallah. But they have to have sincerity to be guided and don't have any preconceived idea on not fishing for faults or whatever it may be. Wallahu a'lam. Now Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam happened, gone through the difficulties that he was gone through. On the way back, he's now trying to get away from these people. He says he goes to a ha'it. It's a wall that he will use as a shield to be protected from these people. لعتبه وشيبه ابن ربيعه عتبه ابن ربيعه وشيبه ابن ربيعه. Even though they were staunch enemies in Mecca, but when they saw him in this state, they sort of felt compassionate toward him. Subhanallah, ya akhi. Imagine. So it says, one of the narrations says there was a ghamam, like a cloud to hover over Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to cover him from the shade. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat down, his back against the wall, or some narration says he stood under a tree for the shade. And now he says this beautiful dua. He says, Allahumma anta rabbi wa rabb al-mustada'afin. And the dua, mashallah, it's a beautiful dua. It said, oh Allah, ashku ilayka, oh Allah, I complain to you, ضعفي, ضعف قوتي, وقلة حيلتي, وهواني على الناس. Oh Allah, I complain to you. So we learn something here too. When we complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you ask a brother or sister, how are you, akhi? Says, you know, my kidney is killing me. The kids are driving me nuts. My wife is doing that. Or my husband is doing this. The bills are too much. I cannot afford this anymore. I don't have a job. My health is going down the drains. I'm going bankrupt. And the weather is terrible. And I have to do this. And I'm in the end of all that long list, he goes, لكن الحمد لله على كل حال. But anyway, alhamdulillah. Because after this long list, akhi, why don't you say alhamdulillah ala kulli hal? When a'udhu billahi min hali ahli an-nar. That's what you're supposed to say. You're supposed to say alhamdulillah under any circumstances. And we seek refuge Allah from the dwellers of the hellfire. But after you give me that list, where is sabr al-jameel, akhi? Where is the beautiful patient? You complain only to Allah. We are allowed to complain to others. We're not saying that, but we're saying, look how Prophet ﷺ used to complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma inni ashku ilayka da'fa quwwati. Oh Allah, I complain to you with the weakness of my power. Wa qillat hilati. I don't have this worldly affair, you know, the things that I should be doing. And wa hawani ala nas. People belittle me. And he says, Allahumma anta rabbi. ورب المستضعفين ولكن وانت ارحم الراحمين ورب المستضعفين. And you are the Lord, the most compassionate, most merciful. And you are the Lord of those who seek strength in you, those weak who are seeking strength in you. إلا من تكلني. Where are you, who are you leaving me for? إلى بعيد يتجهمني. It's those people that will mistreat me like that. أو عدو ملكته أمري. This adu, the people of Quraysh, they now control what I do and what I don't. After, of course, as we mentioned, death of Abu Talib and Khadija radiallahu anhu arda. إن لم يكن بك علي غضب فلا أبالي. If you're not angry with me, فلا أبالي. Some of the scholars says he mentioned this because he thought he was not being maybe the etiquettes and so on. He was afraid that he may have said something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be displeased. Hasha, of course not. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see how he treated him after, just to make sure that the status of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, if you're not angry with me, fala ubali. I don't care about anything else. I remind you of a line from a poem, akhi and ukhti, from this Hadi al-Tariq, the That's something that you're supposed to have as a companion with you on the path. This hadith tariq, this poet, the shi'r, says, فَلْيَرْضَ عَنِّي النَّاسُ أَوْ فَلْيَسْخَطُوا أَنَا لَمْ أَسْعَى لِغَيْرِ رِضَاكَ فَلْيَرْضَ عَنِّي النَّاسُ أَوْ فَلْيَسْخَطُوا If people are pleased with me, they're displeased with me, أَنَا لَمْ أَعُدْ أَسْعَى لِغَيْرِ رِضَاكَ I am only seeking your pleasure. So who do you have to please first, أخي أختي? Do you have to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ? Or do you really care what people think? Have you ever thought, what would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala think? Have you ever thought, ukhti, you know, I can't wear the hijab because people will think I'm passé. I'm, you know, old fashioned. I'm behind the caves. Or I belong to these people called terrorists. Or I'm being oppressed if I wear the hijab. Or if I have the whatever it is, akhi and ukhti. Is that what you're really worried about? You shouldn't be worried about anybody else because those who please Allah and the displeasure of people, Allah will please with them and force people to be pleased with them. But if you displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to please people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be displeased with you and will force people to be displeased with you too. So count on the one, ya akhi, that has the keys for heaven or hell. What people will help you? They won't come and help you, wallahi, on judgment day. Everyone will say, nafsi, nafsi, myself, myself. They will not come and help you in the grave. They will not come and give you the answers for the questions and so on. So be smart. Because the scholars say the sign of a happy person are three. مَنْ يَتْرُكَ الدُّنْيَا قَبْلَ أَنْ تَتْرُكُهُ Those who leave their life before it leaves them. وَمَنْ يَبْنِي قَبْرَهُ قَبْلَ يَسْكُنَهُ Those who build their grave before they live in it. And وَمَنْ يَرْضِي رَبَّهُ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَلْقَاهُ And those who please Allah before they meet Him, أخي. Not to please the people. And remember, again, the signs among the times, يا أخي. That you will love, يُحِبُّونَ الْقُسُورُ وَيَنْسَوْنَ الْقُبُورُ يُحِبُّونَ الْمَالُ وَيَنْسَوْنَ الْحِسَابُ يُحِبُّونَ الْمَخْلُوقُ وَيَنْسَوْنَ الْخَالِقِ It's impossible for you to be that. You cannot be among those three. The three, which one? It says, يُحِبُّونَ الْقُصُورِ They love castles, وَيَنْسَوْنَ الْقُبُورِ And they forgive the graves. يُحِبُّونَ الْمَالِ They love wealth, materialistic possession. وَيَنْسَوْنَ الْحِسَابِ And they forget the reckoning. You will be accountable for everything. And يُحِبُّونَ الْمَخْلُوقِ You love people and you forget the creator, يا أخي. الخالق. So we cannot be among those. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ continues with his dua. He says, إِن لَمْ يَكُنْ بِكَ غَضَبٌ عَلَيَّ فَلَا أُبَالِي لَكَ الْعُدْبَ حَتَّى تَرْضَى وَلَكِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِوَجْهِكَ الَّذِي أَشْرَقَتْ بِهِ نُورُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَصَلَحَتْ بِهِ أُمُورُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ With Prophet Muhammad ﷺ says that I will seek refuge in you from this. فَلَكَ الْعُدْبَ حَتَّى تَرْضَى وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِكَ If you're upset with me, if you're not pleased with me, you can actually do the remorse and complain about it or do whatever it takes for you to be pleased with me. حتى ترضى, to be pleased with me. And ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بك. لا يتحول شيء من شيء إلا بالقوة الله. And nothing will change from one situation to another except by your power, O Allah. And that's a straight belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and infinite power and wisdom, inshaAllah, that everything happens for a reason and nothing will happen without His permission, without His knowledge, and without His power, and so on. So now, on the way, he sat down under that, as we mentioned before, in the garden of Aba ibn Shu'bah, Utbah wa Shaybah, ibn Rabi'ah. So now they sent a man called Addas. It's a beautiful story. A man called Addas, he was their servant, and he was a Christian man. So they tell him, like, here, take these grapes, go to him, give it to him. He felt sorry for him, subhanAllah. Now, Addas, radiallahu anhu, he was not a Muslim yet. He comes up to him, he says, this is for you. It was from my masters, so-and-so. And Prophet Muhammad reaches for it and says, as we briefly mentioned before, he says, Bismillah. So how are you doing, akhi and ukhti? As soon as food comes in, you go, let's dig in, let the games begin. Get away from me, I'm busy now. It's chow time. Why don't we say Bismillah, ya akhi, like the sunnah. When Prophet ﷺ says, when the food is, say Bismillah, Sammi, wa kul biyaminik, and eat with the right hand, wa kul mimma yaleek. Let's go back to the sunnah, inshaAllah, and eat from the front of you, and so on. So by that one word, akhi, one word, Prophet ﷺ says, Bismillah. Addas was staunched. He never heard this before. He says, what is this? Ma'ahid alayhi al-Arab. It's something that I haven't heard before. He says, we are, so on, and he started to ask. He says, min ayna anta ya Addas? And we learned something else here. He says, where are you from, Addas? He called him by name. So, akhi, in the best way for da'wah, you should memorize the person you're talking to. At least his name, inshaAllah. So the brother says, whatever, we'll call him Mahmoud for now, okay? Because he will become a Muslim, inshaAllah. So, how you doing? What's your name? Mahmoud. Okay, brother Ahmed. I said Mahmoud. Okay, brother Muhammad. Okay, Mahmoud, ya akhi, wallah. Abdul Hamid. Abdul Wadud. Allahu musta'an. Ya akhi Mahmoud, I said wallahi. So Prophet Muslim is teaching us. He says, ya Addas. He listened to it once. He remembered now. He says, min ayna anta ya Addas? He says, I'm Addas. He told him. He called him by his name. So let us start now. Learn how to give da'wah. Be personal. Something it's more of the etiquettes and matters of giving the da'wah according to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he says, min ayna anta? Where are you from, Addas? He says, min Ninawa. He says, this city is not very well known. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, min balad Yunus ibn Matta. He says, this is the city of Yunus, which is Jonah in English. Ibn Matta, the son of Matta. He said, min ayna laka? How did he know this? He says, hada akhi, huwa nabi wa ana nabi. Look at the humbleness of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the way he used the art of da'wah. We should learn, inshallah. First, he made something to give him a proof. No one knows this. I mean, according is a prophet, as you will see, he is the statement of Addas later on. He mentioned that. And second, he said something that is humbled. He says, "Huwa nabi wa ana nabi." He didn't say, I'm a prophet and he's a prophet. No, he started with him. He says, هذا أخي يونس بن متى هو نبي وأنا نبي. He is my brethren. My brother, Yunus. He is a prophet and I am a prophet. So he put himself after. He didn't put himself first. So what happened? When Addas heard this, he started kissing his hand and feet and his head. And he declared the shahada. Who was watching? His masters, of course. عتبة وشيبة ابن ربيعة. He says, أفسد علينا الغلام. He said, he spoiled this man. We lost this man. He just sat with him for a few minutes and the man is spoiled already. What happened? So how long have you been a Muslim for, akhi, and you've been dealing with these people? Not one person asked you about Islam for the... I'm not asking you to be the best da'iyah and turn people by, you know, the magic wand and, you know, by your, you know, as you're walking by, go, wow, what a beautiful man, I want to be a Muslim. I'm not asking you to be that, but at least, you know, look at the way it is. This is behavior, etiquettes, manners, conduct. I'll tell you the proof. This is a true story. I believe it was in the UK. Some of the people went to the university there, they spoke in Arabic, and every time that a lady comes in, a colleague, comes close by, as soon as she comes close enough and wants to ask him something or whatever, that's halal, inshallah, they turn into English, they speak into English. So she noticed the first time. Every time it happens, so you can understand now, one person is talking about, you know, that Arabic, a very rough language, I'm a haq and I'm a brain, all that stuff. And this woman comes in, or that person comes in, and you start talking, yeah, pinky up, pish posh, how you going, and all that, you know, that lovely British accent. It's so, mashallah. Anyway, and what happens after this, she started asking, why? They said, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that. He says, when you speak a language that are common, everyone will know. Look at that. The beauty of Islam teaches us this. By establishing one sunnah, this woman became a Muslim. 6 months later, she became a Muslim. She declared the shahada. By the establishing one sunnah, by adhering to the teaching of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, people will become Muslims, inshallah, ya akhi. Lead by example, walk in pulpit, by your role model, by your actions, your matters, your etiquettes and your moral conduct, your behavior. It's the best way for da'wah. And remember again we said, she said she asked him about something. And that's the proof in the Quran. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ قُلْ. They ask you about, say. So you can understand now why Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the best teacher. We learn from him, we follow, inshallah. So he says, يَا عَدَّاسِ. So when he mentioned, and he talked about him being humbled, mentioned Yunus ibn Matta, no one would know that. So he goes back to them, to Shayba and Utbah. He goes back, يَا سَيِّدِي. He says, what happened to you? He goes, يَا سَيِّدِي. He told me something only a prophet would know. Because he told him about Ninwa and Yunus ibn Matta, alayhi salatu wasalam, and so on. He says, Wayhak, wayhak ya Addas, deenuka khayrun min deenih. Your religion is better than his religion. SubhanAllah, look at the frame of mind and what they had. Of course, it wasn't to be. Some of the opinions of the scholars that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam specifically for that place. For whom? For the sake of Addas. Allahu Akbar. That's a great honor for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send the seal of the prophets and messengers to that place in order for Addas to listen to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and him become a Muslim. Could you imagine, akhi and ukhti, the honor of Addas radiallahu anhu warda? Now, after this, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam moved on. On the way back to Mecca, feeling sort of let down, only to find Jibreel alayhi salam descending, وَمَعَهُ مَلَكُ الْجِبَالِ. With him was the angel of the mountains. And now he's telling Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heard what these people said to you and not believing in you. And he brought with me the angel of the mountains. Under your command, يُطْبِقُ عَلَيْهِمْ الْأَخْشَبَيْنِ. Under your command, that the mountains of Akhshabayn, those two mountains, will set asunder, destroy them all. Of course, if it was you, akhi and ukhti, these people, I'll show them who they were messing around with. Don't you know who I am? Can you deal with that? You threw me with it. You did this. You did. Don't you know who I am? And all that stuff. Of course, mountains asunder? Great. I want a first front show. I want to see this baby live right now. Do them. Don't have mercy on them. Let the games begin. Ding. I want to see this, right? Allahu Akbar. But it wasn't Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, don't do that. He says, maybe, just maybe, min aslabihim, from their offsprings, the lineage, the progeny, will come of those who people who say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, ya'budun Allah, la yushriku bihi shay'a. As you will see later on in the seerah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave that to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen to the speech and follow the best of it, and hold on to La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, wa akhir da'wam, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa sallam ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in.